Madam, shall we start?
Start చేసేయండి.
మీరు వీడియో ఆన్ చేసుకోండి.
అది నాది రావట్లేదు ఏంటి?
అవును. స్టార్ట్ వీడియో అని ఉంటుంది మేడం ఆప్షన్.
జూమ్
జూమ్ లో లెఫ్ట్ కార్నర్ బాటమ్ సైడ్.
ఒకసారి ఒకసారి మళ్ళీ మళ్ళీ ఒకసారి పోస్ట్ చేయమా. స్క్రీన్ షేర్ కనిపిస్తుంది కదా?
కనపడుతుంది. స్టార్ట్ చేద్దామా?
చేసి
మీ స్లైడ్ షో పెట్టుకోండి మేడం. స్లైడ్ షోలో పెట్టు.
ఓకే.
గుడ్ ఈవినింగ్ టు ఆల్. Welcome to today's lecture on training and pruning in cocoa by Dr. M. Kalpana, Associate Professor, College of Horticulture, Venkatramanagudam. So all of you are well aware of Madam because she has taken already three classes, two classes in coconut and one class in cocoa. So last class she has covered good agricultural practices in cocoa, and today she is going to address you about training and pruning in cocoa. Madam has vast experience in research, particularly in crops like coconut, cocoa and oil palm. So her experience and her knowledge will definitely help you, so please listen carefully. So now I request Dr. M. Kalpana ma'am to please start the lecture.
Thank you, Sujata. Good evening participants and my dear colleagues. Today I am going to brief you about training and pruning in cocoa. You already know that I am Dr. Kalpana, working as an associate professor at College of Horticulture, Venkatramanagudam. Last week I just briefed you about the good agricultural practices in cocoa. This training and pruning is a part of good agricultural practices in cocoa. So now coming to the lectures. So I will just give a brief introduction on cocoa. I already covered full length of lecture on cocoa in the last class, but just I want to brief it now. Cocoa theobroma cocoa belongs to a family Malvaceae, which is an indigenous to South America, and I already told this that the tribal people that like Mayas, Toltecs and Aztecs, they knew the plant more than 3000 years ago, because this Theobroma bicolor is in one of the species under Theobroma was known to this Mayan tribal people who are one of the Indian race in America. Yes, they know very well about this cocoa because they had been cultivating this cocoa before 3000 years ago, which was wild, and it is inferior in the quality. Like that, this cocoa thus has one of the oldest histories among the crops that are cultivated by the man, but it was introduced to the new world only during 17th and 18th centuries. I already told that these people, they used to prepare one drink through grounded cocoa beans, grounded and roasted cocoa beans, then that mace and also some pepper they used to make a drink called chocolate. So this chocolate is very bitter in taste, but when this crop is introduced to the European countries by Spaniards, they thought it is bitter in taste, and they modified this drink as supplemented this maize and the pepper, that is corn flour and pepper, with milk and chocolate. Thus the chocolate comes into existence, and this chocolate now it is widely accepted by all age groups of humankind. So coming to its production, here are some of the top cocoa growing countries like Ivory Coast, Ghana, Ecuador, Cameroon, Nigeria, Indonesia and Brazil, because it is one of the most important tropical crop, which has its distribution between 10 degrees north and 10 degrees south around the equator. So among these countries, the African region, American region, Asia and Oceania, the African countries, that Ivory Coast, Ghana, Nigeria are most cocoa producing countries with respect to their area and the production. And also this Asian countries like Indonesia and Malaysia, American countries like Brazil, Ecuador, and the ocean countries like Papua New Guinea. Among all these countries, the Ivory Coast and the Ghana are the largest cocoa exporters in the world. Coming to its production scenario in India, actually this cocoa is cultivated in southern states, especially Kerala, Karnataka, Tamil Nadu, and Andhra Pradesh, with an area of 0.93 lakh hectares and a production of 17,985 metric tons and the productivity of 580 kgs per hectare. But the highest productivity was observed in Andhra Pradesh, that is almost 800 kgs per hectare. Nowadays, this cocoa is also spreading to the non-traditional areas of northeastern region of the country. So this is the area production and area production of cocoa in India. I already told that Andhra Pradesh got second place in its area. The first place was occupied by Tamil Nadu. And with regard to the production and productivity, Andhra Pradesh stands first, and this followed by Karnataka. In Andhra Pradesh also, it got almost 26,600 hectares of land is occupied with cocoa under coconut, oil palm and arecanut gardens. But the maximum area and production is concentrated in East and West Godavari districts. And among East and West Godavari, West Godavari is the leading district in both income area and production. So this is the brief history of area production and its distribution into the world. Coming to its life cycle, why I am stressing the life cycle of cocoa is because the pruning and training operation entirely depends upon the after harvesting. This got vivid parity nature. Immediately we can go in the field. Around 3 to 4 weeks it starts germinating. About the 6 months, the seedlings are ready for transplanting. It comes to first flowering after 24 months, but we will restrict the flowering in the earlier days, and actual year will take from three years onwards. From 4 to 5 years, around 5 years, it is in complete mature stage. Once maturity, it goes on increasing. Once matured with a productivity of a peak at 10 years, the tree has year-round flowering and bears fruit, flowers and fruits simultaneously. Like that, the flowers will pollinate with the midges, and then within 5 to 7 months, the fruit gets matured. This is all about the life cycle of cocoa. And one of the articles, they have described the principal growth stages of cocoa plant from 0 to, they had given up to 8th stage. Here the stage when where actual leaf development on the main stem of the young plant, and the fan branches will develop immediately after sowing. The root will develop and the shoot will comes out, and the leaf development on the main stem of the young plant and on the fan branches will see in the stage 1. In stage 2, the main branches start elongating, leading to a formation of fan like branches. The main stem, it got orthotropic growth, whereas the fan branches got plagiotropic growth. So the formation of the jarket is through plagiotropic growth, and again from the base of this fan branches, that is the jarket, the lateral bud develops into a chupon, which grows and gives to a second jarket. It is, we will describe it as tires. If you won't stop growth in cocoa, it will go up to 5 to 6 tires, means almost to a height of 10 meters. This is why we want to restrict the growth, and also to increase the productivity, we'll go for training and pruning in cocoa. So this is the stage where 5th to 8th stage, where the inflorescence emerges on the stem. Stem and branches, nothing but the cauliflowers flowering. It develops into, the flowers get pollinated and they develop into a complete pod within 5 to 7 months. So I already told this cocoa head is a dimorphic branching, means there is a distinct type of branching. The orthotropic growth is intermittently interrupted by degeneration of this terminal bud below which branches develop. You can see here clearly the 5 branches developed after degeneration of this terminal bud. This is nothing but the jarket, we'll tell. So the growth in this cocoa, it's a discontinuous process. In a successive growth phase, we can see the fleshes. Each flesh production of 5 to 6 alternate leaves, almost 5 to 6 alternate leaves with short petioles, and almost 4 to 5 fleshes occur in a year, which depends upon the climatic condition. Especially the temperature and rainfall mainly influences the production of these fleshes in cocoa. Then coming to its flowering, the flowering mainly depends upon the favorable physiological soil and climatic conditions. You can see the cauliflowers type of cauliflowers and ramiflowers type of flowering in cocoa, where the cushions will develop on the after the falling of the leaf axil, the cushion will form. Each cushion consists of almost 5 to 50 flowers, which are pollinated by the midges, ants, and the thrips. Okay, this within 36 hours after pollination, fertilization will lead to the formation of young okra-sized pod, nothing but it's a chiral, and this chiral, it will develop into longitudinal elongation will be there, and the girth increases, which develop into fully matured cocoa pod. It almost take 150 to 180 days between the fertilization and the pod maturation, and the pods and the pod, we can say it as a the technical term for the fruit is pod, which contains in a high yielding plant it varies almost 60 to 80 pods per tree per year, and the average number of beans which are the economical part of this cocoa, which the beans are used for chocolate making, it almost varies from 30 to 40 beans per pod. Then coming to generally, this cocoa is traditionally it is grown as grown in agroforestry system, where there is low fertile land and more shade will be there, and there is overage, and because of that there is a low productivity and there is no quality control in African countries. Whereas in India, we are growing this cocoa. Actually, this crop is introduced as an intercrop in coconut gardens in the Wayanad districts of Kerala, and further this Mondelez company people, they commercialized the this crop by giving seedling materials and technical know-how to the farming community. Like this crop has entered into India during almost 1965, and the commercial cultivation started in the year 1970s. In AP, the commercial cultivation started in the year 1990s. So this crop mainly grown as an intercrop in coconut garden, arcanut gardens, oil palm, and nowadays it is cultivating as a solo crop or under open conditions. So the training and pruning aspect is very important with regard to this cocoa management. Why means it is growing here the both shade management as well as the training and the pruning of the cocoa plant. It influences the yield of the plant because the cocoa is grown as an intercrop in coconut garden, arcanut and oil palm gardens, which varies in their covering of the crop. Here in coconut garden, generally cocoa is grown as a single hedge or in double hedge, where coconut is spaced at 7.5 into 7.5, and the cocoa is planted at 2.7 to 3 meters, which accommodate almost 444 trees per hectare. This topic I already covered while we dealt with good agriculture practices in cocoa. Just I want to go fast here. Here the double hedge system where the cocoa is planted at a spacing of 2.5 to 2.7 meters. And the population here accommodate is 800 trees per hectare. When we go as a single hedge system, here we can go for the to second tier also. Up to second tier will restrict the height of the cocoa plant. If you go in a double hedge system, here in double hedge system, we can allow the crop to only the first jacket, that is the first tier. Beyond that, we cannot go because there is a overshading or overshading of the crop, and there will be a decrease in the yield. So coming to arecanut, in arecanut, the cocoa is spaced at 2.7 meters, which will accommodate around 686 plants per hectare. Then coming to oil palm, where the square system of planting is followed in the oil palm, cocoa is placed at 2.4 to 3 meters, or in four oil palm plants, we can center it in the middle, like that, around 4.5 centimeters away from the oil palm tree. Then coming to under open conditions, we can space it around 2.7 to 3 meters, where the population accommodated is around 680 plants per hectare, and the average dried bean yield here it is 3 to 3.5 kgs per tree per year. In this open system of planting, we can go for cocoa up to 2 and 3 tiers also, because why means it requires as a self-shading, because cocoa is a shade tolerant plant. It has to need the shade at the earlier stages of its growth. 50% of shade is required at the early stages of its growth. This is all about the planting of cocoa in different cropping systems. This I already covered in last class. There is a huge demand of 212,000 tons by 2050, and the estimated supply is only 121,000 tons, but there is a wide gap of 90 tons. Then how to reach this, we can see. To achieve higher yields with better quality, we have to take care from spacing and planting system till harvest, where training and pruning also plays an important role for getting a better high yield and better quality and good quality beans in cocoa. So I want to brief about the growth, how the growth is there in cocoa. I already told you that this is the seedling population. When the seed is sown, the germination, after germination, you can see the seedling with a rhythmic branching. So
Here there, if you see the third picture, there is a formation of first plagiotropic stage, and this is the adult stage, and this is the stage where the base of the plagiotropic acts and the mechanism of relay in the growth in height, and and you can see the plan of tire system in 3 meter, where you can see the articulated structure, and this is the rhythm, the rhythmic growth and articulated structure, and the axillary position of the flowers. So this growth is very important for training and pruning of the cocoa plant. So here you can see the orthotropic growth with the terminal bud, and when it reaches to a height of 1 to 1.5 meters, this terminal bud, it degenerates, and a fan type it gives to plagiotropic growth, which is nothing but a jarket. We will also call it as a tire. Almost 2 to 5 branches will be there in this tire or prong, and after that this it will continue ongoing development of cocoa, both orthotropic and plagiotropic. And from base of this plagiotropic fan branches, a terminal bud which will grows into a chupa, just like a chupa, it goes into a height of again 1 to 2 meters higher than the first tire, and even higher if light is a limiting factor. That's why if you see in forestry, agroforestry system, the cocoa got a very lanky growth, having a this tire system at a spacing of almost 2 meters and above. Okay, this is all about the growth. How we can control this growth? What is meant by pruning in cocoa, and what is its uses? When you do pruning, what will happen? If you do not do pruning, what will happen? I will give at glance lecture. What is meant by pruning in cocoa? It is nothing but cutting of the branches that are dying, or we can make the tree more to give more production, and by removing the fan branches, by removing the unwanted non-productive branches and diseased and dead branches, removing the diseased pods, etc., so that there will be more light infiltration into the that fall on the main trunk, and also fan branches, which is important for the flowering and the fruit development. There will be a development of fruits, more number of fruits, that gives to the productivity of the crop. Okay, so actually in cocoa we'll call 2 types of pruning we'll generally follow. One is the structural pruning or formation pruning. It is nothing but the training we will call, and every year we will be doing the annual pruning or sanitation pruning. This what is the principle or what is the objective that lies behind the pruning is mainly for establishment of a strong framework for the tree, first thing. And the second thing is, it will facilitate, if you prune the branches, if you do training, it will facilitate the management of the tree, and also the crop cultural operations like weeding, manuring, harvesting, spraying, etc. Because of that we will go for training. Then coming to, if you leave the crop as such, now I already told it will give almost 5 to 6 tries and to grows to a height of 10 meters. Mainly to restrict the height, which absorbs, which harvests the sunlight very efficiently. Thereby, there will be a high productivity in cocoa. That is the main principle lies between the training of a cocoa. So I already told that training is nothing but the formation pruning or training in young plants. The main objective here is to design the height of the first jarket. I told you this plant will use the jarket at a height of 1 to 1.5 meters to design the height of a first jarket, and to decide the number of the fan branches, and also to allow the optimum number of the fan branches per jacket. I told it, if you leave it, almost gives 5 to 6 jackets reaching a height of 10 meters. So to optimize the number of fan branches and also to decide how many jackets should be there per one tree. So how we can do all this? Immediately after planting, around 6 to 12 months of old seedlings are to be trained and are checked with formation pruning. This is the age. In the early stages of the crop only, we have to do this formation pruning. I already told, it gives a jacket crop about 12 months, almost 18 months old, that is 1.5 years after planting, it gives the first jacketing. So before giving a first jacketing only, we have to train the plant in such a way to give a good arc framework to the plant. And the jacketing height should be restricted to 1 to 1.5 meters, mostly especially in the intercropping system, that is in coconut cropping system, cocoa oil palm cropping system, and arecanut cropping system. And also the main objective is to maintain the canopy in a single tier by regular removing and limiting the number of chupons arising from the main stem. I'll show all the pictures for all this. If the jacketing is at lower levels, it almost affects the cultural operations, then what to do? So we have to nip the plant branches to the jacket immediately after development. This will facilitate the chupons just below the cut end. Among the many chupons, allow only the most vigorous and straight one to grow and remove the other ones. This chupon will lead to the fan branchings again at a desired height. If there is two stems in a plant, retain the most vigorous one and remove the other one. So here I told you that this is the height where the jacket will form after 18 months after planting, almost 1 to 1.5 meters height. This jacketing we should manage within 6 to 12 months of planting. So this is the form of jacketing. And so in the meanwhile, while growing and before formation of jacketing, you will get a number of suckers that develop on the main stem. So remove all these suckers in order to have a good and vigorous growth of the main stem, and also the dominance nature of the main stem. We have to remove all the suckers, otherwise the main stem won't get so much of strong framework. So this is the best method of jacketing, and this is the wrong method of jacketing, where we got two jackets at the base level only. So these are 3 to 5 branches exactly spaced around almost equally spaced. You can see the fan branches that are equally spaced here, and this is also on the side view. 3 to 5 fan branches should be retained on in the jacket. Okay, and the second thing is, for mainly to restrict the height of height, we are going for this training operation, and the height should be around 3 to 4 meters. 4 meters of height. If it is under open system, you can go up to 5 meters of height. So this will facilitate care and protection from the winds, and also excessive light, and also cold temperatures. It will protect the plant from all these adverse conditions, and also there will be a filtered light that falls on the stem and the fan branches. So this is all about the training. Training nothing but the structural pruning at the early stage of the crop. If the jacketing is not formed at a desired height, then what measures you have to take? If the terminal bud got damaged, what measures you have to take? If you have two stems on the main stem at different heights, then what measures do you have to take? Just I will explain very fast. Here you can see that this is the terminal bud growing, and when the terminal bud is damaged by any of the insect or any of the pest or the fallen leaf from coconut, oil palm or any leaf that damages the terminal bud, then you have to decap this terminal bud part. And if you decap it, there will be a induce of this chupon, and again it will initiate branching. This is one method of forming jorquetting. Next comes to the second method. Here you can see the only at a lower height the jorquet is formed with two branches. In such type of condition, one vigorous one we should retain and remove the other one, so that the vigorous one, it will form the first jorquet, and again chupon will rise and form the second jorquet or second tire. And this is another method. Here the jorquetting height is only less than 50 centimeters. In such type of also, we have to retain the most vigorous one and remove the other one, so that there will be an equal, there is a desired height of jorquetting. So I already told, if there is jorquetting at a lower height, means below 1 meter or 1.5 meter, and the second jorquet is going to form, means we have to take care very promptly, and the second jorquet should restrict, and also after development of the second jorquet, we have to remove the branches slowly at the young age only, so that the jorquet will be formed little bit at a higher level. When the jorquet is formed at the lower level, the there will be very difficult in carrying out the cultural operations under field conditions. Generally, what farmers will do is they will plant the plant, and they won't take much care after planting of the crop. Only they will concentrate after jorquet formation, and also after giving the first crop of up to 2 years. Before that, they will neglect the crop. In such type of conditions, the exact position of jorquet won't be available. So here you can see the young shoot, two shoots coming out, and here the multiple shoots. Plagiotropic, orthotropic and plagiotropic shoots. You can see multiple ones. In such type of conditions, you have to remove the less vigorous ones and retain the more vigorous ones for further growth and development. Just a minute. So the pruning, the formation training and formation pruning and training is different for the seedling population and also for grafted population. Why? Means for the seedling population, the jorquet formation will be at 1 to 1.5 meters, whereas for budded or grafted plants, the jorquetting is at lower height. So in such type of conditions, how to prune these seedlings? First of all, we have to adjust the first jorquet at least at 1 to 2 meters of height, and retain 4 to 5 branches, strong branches in 4 direction, which should have a balanced framework. Then the vertical growth should be restricted to first jorquetting when it is planted in double head system of planting in coconut or single head system of planting in oil palm. So this is the canopy structure. We have to restrict the height to a vertical height to a first jorquetting. Here you can see the Canopy is almost like a cone shape or a umbrella structure, and the canopy spread should be around 3.8 to 4 meters, and the height should be 2.7 to 3 meters, which is an ideal for seedling population. This is the common canopy architecture for seedling for seedling population, which is ideal. You can follow it in double hedge system or under coconut, or a single hedge system in oil palm or arcanut. This is the farmer where he trained. You can see all are in equal height with a good jarketing position. So when it comes to the grafting or budding budded clones, here we have to follow two types of pruning. One is the primary formation pruning and the secondary formation pruning. In primary formation pruning, we will be doing it the first year of the planting. Why means the supporting framework of one or more upward growing main stems are allowed in this cloned plants. You can see the supporting structure of one or more. In sometimes only two will be there, in sometimes three will be there. So the supporting frameworks in some conditions you can see three, but it will almost will be two to four you can see. Then the drooping branches, the drooping or inward growing branches, you have to remove this grafted or budded plants, especially during the first year of planting, so that the framework will be like it is just like funnel shape. You can see from the third year onwards we have to do the secondary pruning, where the canopy architecture is just like umbrella or cone shape, and the canopy area should be around 3.8 meters to 4 meters spread, and the height should be 2.7 meters height we have to recommend. Then in the later stages, the canopy shape, it will come almost like funnel shape. This is the canopy architecture in grafted or budded plants. So you can see here clearly, this is before pruning how it is. After pruning, the grafted or budded plant is just like a cone shape, funnel shape. Okay. So, and next coming to this all about the formation pruning or training of the cocoa at younger stages. Then coming to the pruning of cocoa, it's the main objective of the pruning of cocoa is to increase the crop production. How we will increase the crop production, I'll tell, and reduce the pest and disease infestation, especially cocoa pod and pod borer and black pod rot disease, and the control the shape and the height of the tree, and ensures the, which ensures the easy access for cultural operation and also the pod harvest. You can see how we can manage means. Just I will brief it here and I will show the pictures. First, we have to remove the additional branches within 60 centimeters of the jarket. See, we have to remove the additional branches that are surrounding around the 60 centimeters near the jarket. It should be free from additional branches, and this branches should be free so that the structure will be, the framework will be very strong. And the second thing is, we have to remove the chupons, water shoots, dead branches, that epiphytes, climbing plants, then rodent damage, then rotten ripe pods. Very regular interval you have to remove. Then we have to maximum the maximum leaf area, and also avoid shelf shading by trimming. These pruned trees should have at least 20 to 30 leaves per developing pods. So based on that, we have to do the pruning operation. I will show in pictures how we can do this pruning operation. And this pruning operation, why we will do means mainly to ensure adequate ventilation in the garden, and also to maintain the tree height, and reduces the fungal infestation that spreads the diseases, and also for making spraying and harvesting operations very easy at the farm level. If you see the coconut, it will provide a lot of space. So at that type of cropping system in coconut cocoa cropping system, there we can go for two-storied canopy architecture we can follow, and the maintenance pruning you have to take up almost 2 to 3 times in humid environmental conditions, and the plots with adequate shade and water, and also the canopy area should be around 15 to 20 meters square under plant-based cropping system, and every time you have to remove the coupons. And also by doing all this, there is equal distribution of the nutrients towards the pod. Means by cutting away the new and unproductive coupons on the mature tree, the pod size will also increase. Thereby we will increase the production of pods. Then diseased unwanted branches we have to remove, especially this vascular dieback we have to remove regularly to maintain the health and the vigor of the plant. And also these pruned branches should be removed from the garden. By means here, the small ones, small branches and leaf litter you can use for decomposition, but the big branches you have to remove from the garden. Almost I told you that 100 kgs per hectare of hectare per year organic matter will return to the soil through the pruned cocoa leaf litter. So and also this pruning we can divide it into central pruning of cocoa tree, pruning of cocoa tree per height, and top pruning, maintenance pruning, and sanitary pruning. I will explain one by one. This central pruning is nothing but here we have to remove all the shoots that are present within 60 centimeters from the body of the tree, and also the coupons arising from the arising on the main branch we have to remove, because it is to avoid the production of non-essential branches. So you can free all these around 2 meter feet we have to remove all the coupons, additional branches, water shoots, etc., so that there will be a almost we are centering the tree so that for easy operation of all cultural operations, and also for getting of the maximum light infiltration on the main stem and also the fan branches that will be utilized for the production of flowering and production of flowering and fruit development. Then coming to pruning for height, I already told we have to restrict the height of the tree. If you won't restrict the height of the tree, it almost reaches around 10 meters of height. So especially in coconut, oil palm, and arcanut garden, we have to restrict the height to 4 meters of 3 to 4 meters of height. If you go for open conditions, you can go up to the three-tier system. Here we have to limit the height to almost 3 to 4 meters by removing all the drooping branches, and also removing the additional branches on the fan branches near the jacket. This is before pruning and this is after pruning. And the third one is top working. Here also in some gardens you can see the cocoa, it almost goes up to 10 meters height, half of the coconut plant. In such conditions, I told you, we have to top work it by removing the jacketing only, by removing the second, third jacket and restrict the height, and we have to almost prune the branches, unwanted branches and all in top working. So there will be an infiltration of light will be very good. You have to top work just like in convex shape. This is top working, and also we can do the maintenance pruning. In maintenance pruning, what we'll do means we'll remove all the drooping branches that are touching the ground, and also the suckers on the main stem and the suckers on the suckers are have water shoots or additional coupons on the fan branches. This is a maintenance pruning. This pruning we mainly will do during after main harvest, before flowering and before flushing and flowering. This is very important pruning, especially in our conditions. We will do this pruning. Generally, we will do this pruning in April to July. But in our conditions, we will do in July and August. This maintenance pruning will do in the month of July and August. Then comes to the this is the I told you the coupons on the fan branches. You have to remove. We have to remove the coupons that are raising on the main stem. These are the coupons we have to remove on the main stem and also the fan branches. So then comes to the maintenance pruning. In maintenance pruning, we have to restrict the height also so that there will be a good increase in the light and the air movement inside the canopy. This will reduce the disease infestation, especially pod rot and the pod borer and black pod rot disease. See, you can see in some gardens, if you see, these two branches will overlap. You can't enter into the garden. In such type of garden, there will be more humidity inside the canopy that will enhance the attack of pests and diseases. And also during the if the maintenance pruning is not good, the infestation fertilizer application, there will be a new flesh that will pave a way for attack of this sucking complex, especially to the new flesh and also the emerging flowers and pods. So to enhance the pod production and to reduce the fungal disease problem, you have to do the pruning to open crown. Almost open crown we are doing. This is nothing but one of the top working also. So then comes to the sanitary pruning. This is sanitary pruning we have to do periodically. Means you, for every quarterly intervals, you have to do the sanitary pruning by removing the dead twigs and by removing the diseased, damaged pots, damaged rat damaged, squirrel damaged pots. You have to take care for every quarterly month. And this is sanitary pruning we have to do. And maintenance pruning, I told you, in the month of it will start in the month of April to August. Besides that, we have to do the light pruning so that if there is a over canopy production in such type of conditions, light pruning will enhance the infiltration of light on the stem and the branches, so that there will be increase in the production of cocoa production. So then I already told you what time to prune. I told you the heavy pruning means large branches and all we should do during dry, after cessation of dry season or entering into the monsoon season. This maintenance pruning for proper shade, dead branches and coupons is done all year alone. And this pruning, I told you that in our conditions, it is July, August, and the light pruning in October, November, and December months. In Kerala, Karnataka conditions, the light pruning, they will go in the month of June, July, and heavier pruning in after August to September. During August to September, they go for heavier pruning. So how much intensity of pruning we have to do? We are talking about pruning. This time we have to do pruning and all. But how much intensity, how many shoots we have to remove, how much shoot length we have to remove? This is very important. First, we have to calculate the canopy area. Based on the canopy area, 20% of the secondary shoots we have to remove to produce a good number of pods, especially in Tamil Nadu and Andhra Pradesh, where this cocoa crop is mainly cultivated under irrigated conditions. Whereas in Karnataka, South Kannada and Kerala, this cocoa crop mostly they are cultivating under rain-fed conditions. Because of that, they can also go for 20% of removal, but here there will be a more vegetative growth in our conditions under irrigated conditions. Maximum 20% of the total secondary shoots, secondary branches should be removed. Based on this, the Tamil Nadu Agriculture University, they have conducted one experiment. How much intensity of the pruning they have to do, they have taken the control as a farmer's practice and light pruning 10% of the total secondary shoots removal of 20% is the medium pruning, removal of 30% is the hard pruning. And also besides that, they also gone for soil drenching of clacloprazole at the rate of 0.5 and 0.1 gram active ingredient per tree. And also this foliar application of this Cycosil at the rate of 100 ppm and 750 ppm. Among all these, they had a good result. They got a good result with medium pruning. But the hard pruning, they got more number of lateral branches. But the medium pruning, they got only 19.42 of 40 of lateral branches on the pruned area. So among all these, they have got a good pod number per tree in medium pruning. That is 34 number of pods per tree in both seasons they had recorded, and they averaged it and they got 34 number of pods per tree. Then coming to their conclusion, the highest number of the pods and the yield parameters were recorded in medium pruning, and also pruning the trees at 20% canopy removal increases the number of flower cushions and also number of fruits per tree, and also the reduces the light transmission and increases the chlorophyll content. With that experiment, they concluded this experiment as 20% pruning is very good. That is, medium pruning is good both in the production and quality of the beans. So we in Horticulture Research Station Ambajipeta, we also studied the effect of time and the intensity of the pruning on coca under coastal ecosystem of Andhra Pradesh. Here we had taken the different timings, that is June, July, August and September, with the 5% removal, 10% removal, 50% removal and 20% removal. It's a combination of both time and intensity. Among all these, we got the maximum pod yield and dry bean which are harvested in the, which are pruned during August with 15% and also 10% and 15%. It is on par with the August and July and August. So the number of pod weight, number of pod beans also recorded the same. So here, based on this, what we concluded is the best time of pruning in AP conditions is July, August, and with the intensity of 15% to 20%, they recorded the maximum dry bean yield of 2.92 kgs per tree per year. This is the experiment we concluded. While pruning also, we have to take care not to prune with all the implements whatever available, like sickles, next knives and all. We have to use the good tools like pruning shears, secateurs and pruning saw. So what is the benefits of pruning? I already covered. We can attend a nice shape, that is umbrella shape or half moon shape, and this pruning will allow us the maximum sunlight and the air circulation that will reduce the pests and diseases, and also it will allows the workers to apply the fertilizers and other cultural operations. And also the, when you prune, there is an equal distribution of photosynthetes to the both vegetative and the reproductive stages, and we can restrict the height, thereby improves the yield and quality of the beans. So While pruning, we have to take very good precautions. That is, when pruning is done, we have to take care only after the onset of monsoons. You have to prune. We should not do pruning during severe summer. Why means in severe summer at high temperatures, 1 or 2 years, the yields will be good. Afterwards, there will be a scorching on the stem. If once the cushion was flowering cushion was damaged, the plant won't produce till the death of its death of the plant. So the flowering cushion will damage during high temperatures. So we should not prune during high temperatures, and the severe pruning should not be done. The maintenance pruning should be only of 20% of the canopy. We should not go beyond 30% and 40%. That severe pruning will reduces the yields, and also we should not remove the branches that are there in the jarket, and also we should not damage the bark or the branches while pruning. I already told, if you cause damage to the flowering cushion, the plant won't flower till its lifetime. So while pruning, you have to take care to give a minimal distance to the plant with the flowers, the chirals and the pods. Never over prune or expose the jarket to heavy severe sun. Then while pruning, you have to take sharp knives or good pruning tools only you have to use immediately after pruning. You have to go for spraying of copper oxychloride to avoid the secondary infestations. So here you can see the best method of pruning, how they are doing. This is the best method of pruning, and here it's a bad method of pruning. They are leaving the tip as such, and we should not damage the bark while pruning. This is the right way of pruning, and this is the wrong way of pruning. Here we are giving some of the pruning training to the farmers in the oil palm and also the coconut, and these pruning operations are very important for production of a good crop. So here the some of the calendar of farm operations to be followed in young cocoa garden, especially for pruning operation. I'm not giving all the operations, but only for pruning operations. Why the topic is on training and pruning during May to January to May in young gardens. We have to remove the chupons that are rising from the rootstock if grafted or plants are planted, and also from the seedling plants. Then in June, July, we will go for planting of the cocoa plants in the main field. So after planting, if there is an emergence of the any shoots from the rootstocks in the field conditions, you have to remove regularly from June to July. From August to September also, the emerging shoots on the main stems we have to remove, and we have to direct it for formation pruning in young seedlings and also grafted plants, and shining in young plants, and also for structural pruning we have to take care. Why means we are planting the crop in the month of June, July. Then coming to November, December, then also we have to remove the emerging shoots from the main stem, and the pruned material we have to mulch it to the young cocoa gardens. So then coming to the calendar of operations in mature tree, in January we have to the leftover ripe pods from the main harvest season and diseased pods should be harvested carefully with the knife without damaging the flower cushion, and also newly emerged flowers and developing chirals. And if in number of the plants are less, the hanging wilted chirals may be removed gently, and the squirrel damaged ones should be removed. Why means this rain free season is best for rodent control. And during February months, we have to remove the chupons, tea mosquito bugs that attacked the shoots, and dry chirals and the damaged pods should be removed without damaging the flowering cushion. In March also we have to remove the chupans from the main stem. In April months we have to remove the dried twigs, diseased pods, and also diseased pods and rat damaged pods should be removed before onset of the southwest monsoons. Why means we go for the main pruning in the month of June, in the month of July and August after onset of monsoons. In July also we have to remove the chupans that are rising from the main stem. In July, August, the main maintenance pruning has to be done in the mature trees. Maintenance pruning along with the sanitary pruning after main harvest we have to take care, and the slight pruning should be done to ensure the sunlight and aeration in the garden, especially in the west coast condition where the main crop is during rainy season. So then coming during the September, pruning in the mature trees both for the structural and sanitary after the main harvest, and the pruned branches and the leaves should be mulched in the garden. In October, November months also we have to mulch in the garden. In the November month, especially in AP conditions, we have to mulch the garden and we have to go for light pruning to ensure the sunlight and good aeration. In the December month, we have to remove the chupans and dead and dried and dried wood and also dried chirals you have to remove. These are the all the calendar of operations to be followed to get a better yields in to get a better yields and quality in cocoa. So thank you all. If you got any doubts, this is all about training and pruning.
The participants can unmute yourself and ask if you have any doubts, or if you need any clarification, you can unmute yourself and you can ask the question.
So this is the all about training and pruning, especially in the end gardens and the matured gardens, that will leads to the good production and productivity. Especially in Andhra Pradesh, the bean quality is very good with a fat content of almost 45% to 50%. It is ranging. When you do these all operations, good agricultural practices in especially in Andhra Pradesh gardens, you will get a good yields which are on par with the Ghana beans quality. So thank you very much,
madam. I think no questions are posted in the chat box.
Okay, then we can leave.
Let me conclude. Thank you very much, madam, for enlightening the participants with your lecture. Very informative lecture, because you explained everything. What are the advantages? What are different methods of training and pruning? So very effectively through images also. So everything very useful and very self-explanatory also, I think. So in that spent. Thank you, madam.
Thank you, Sujata. Thank you very much for giving an opportunity. This is the last lecture for me. Thank you.
Well, you are the only speaker, I think, who delivered 4 lectures, madam, in this program.
Okay. Thank you,
madam.